Very excited to be here, and I hope I can entertain you a little bit. So I make big, exciting visual projects, but they also have quite serious themes. Some are quite lighthearted and some are quite serious. But I call myself a showwoman as opposed to a showgirl, partly because of my age, which is advancing, and partly because I haven't been a girl for a very long time. And I'm not employed, but I am the employer. I am a woman who runs my own shows. I am a businesswoman. I am an artist. And so in that sense, I am like a showman. Like Barnum was a showman. You might call Derren Brown a showman. But where, we must ask, are the show women? We only know about showgirls. We call Josephine Baker a showgirl. But as the proprietress of my own large ghost train in Blackpool, I firmly believe that I'm a showwoman and not a showgirl. So I'm going to talk about how I became a showwoman. And as I talk, I've got a few DVDs, bits of shows of mine from the last 20 years. And I might look up occasionally and comment on particular bits that you see. So let's see what... Oh, nothing's happening.
Oh, dear.
I'm not very good at technology. Oh, could we put the sound down, though? Yeah, we'll do it without sound, and I'll talk about it. So you'll see different things come up. So I come from a kind of mixed practice in what I do, in that I'm kind of half from the world of live art and half from the world of cabaret. And in fact, I'm really interested in trying to reinvent cabaret using some perspectives, I guess, from what you would call a live art practice. So you can see here some of my ghost train. You can see here me doing a bit of magic. There's all different bits of shows, but my main shows, one was called Jewess Tattooess, and it was all about my identity as a Jewish woman who chooses to get tattooed and looking at the history of decorated women from kind of biblical myth through to the current day. That's from Jewess Tattooess, but also looking at the conflict about being Jewish and having tattoos, and really the whole identity of the marked, scarred, decorated woman from Lilith to tattooed ladies in the fair who worked as exhibits. So, Jewess Tattooess was a very layered show in that I used my own body, storytelling, visual art, film, that's from Jewess Tattooess, to explore my own relationship to women as decorated, as entertainers, as Jewish. So it was a kind of combination of something very spectacular and visual, but something very personal and exploratory. But I also do cabaret, and later tonight I'm going to do a piece of very fun cabaret with one of my favorite collaborators, who is in fact a giant earwig, and she's from the Insect Circus, who I also collaborate with, who are a fantastic circus company who were recently performing at the Roundhouse. That takes me on now to the other big project that I did. There was a few projects after Jewess Tattooess, but I decided I wanted to build a ghost train. And ghost trains are, you know, quite fun things. And they're there to give you a quick thrill. But I, from Jewess Tattooess, was really interested in the history of disappeared people. And in my own family, you know, the idea of lost stories, disappeared women. And then I was meeting a lot of women who... Oh, and I think there's another one after that, maybe, who I was working with as a performer in the London clubs who were from Eastern Europe. And I said, oh, what is your story? How did you make that journey from the East to the West? And I thought it was very interesting that some of their stories were not that dissimilar to the stories of my great-grandparents who crossed the borders from the East to the West over 100 years ago. So I decided to make a ghost train as a kind of memorial to the history of disappeared women between East and West. Which is kind of an obscure idea, but it worked. We did it in Brick Lane, and you might have seen some of the images there. So we built a ghost train, And we worked with some extraordinary performers, and one of them became very famous in that it was Paloma Faith, the now famous pop star. It was her first job out of college. She came to perform in My Ghost Train. And we did a beautiful show with ladies in vintage dresses disappearing to Eastern European music, and it was supposed to be a very emotive ghost ride, not something that was full of shocks and scares, but something that was a moving emotional journey. And the audience actually did have an emotional journey because they moved in electric carriages round the performers. And we tried to engineer a new ride system, which seemed like a really good idea at the time, but was a very complicated thing to do. And especially when we tried to take it to Glastonbury and it began to sink into the mud. And we were very worried we were going to electrocute our lovely performers, but we didn't, and we survived Glastonbury, and we managed to dredge it out of the mud. But I'm going to go back on a couple of stories that I missed, because I wanted to give you anecdotes. My best anecdote tonight is that in some of my work, you know, over in the 90s, I was exploring the body, as I described, and I did some cutting-edge stuff with nudity, you know, before burlesque kind of became very popular, and it really had more of a political context for me why I was using that nudity than just showing the nudity. But I played with a lot of religious imagery, and in fact, I did one of those performances here at the Union Chapel, and the act was that I had a beard like Jesus, and I stood in a small tub, and to the music from Jesus Christ Superstar, to the song I Don't Know How to Love Him by Mary Magdalene, I poured a bottle of red wine over my naked body, crying into my beard. And unfortunately, the Union Chapel weren't too impressed with this show and thought it was a little bit, would make, you know, some of the congregation here or some of the people that use this church unhappy, as it probably would. So in fact, they did decide to remove me from the stage. But we're all friends now, and this evening I'm just working with a giant earwig and a giant doll's house, and hopefully they won't be removing me from the stage. But other things have happened. For instance, when we did Jewess Tattooess in the Serbian Cultural Center, they had armed gunmen on the door, and I said, "What? Why have you got armed gunmen on the door?" And they said, "Well, there is a rise at the moment." This was about 6 years ago. In anti-Semitism, unfortunately, and we're just checking to see that nobody's going to stone you. And, you know, but we got up, we did the show, and, you know, it's been a very bizarre journey that's really taken its own way. You know, on the lighter side of things, you know, I remember I went to a magician's conference, and it was all men and me and a couple of older ladies that had been magician's assistants. And I said, "Why are there no women magicians? Why are there no women illusionists?" And I said it to the, and she said, "Well, you know what I think it is, dear? I think it's that there's nowhere to hide anything in your costume because your boobs are there. The boobs are too big." And I thought, "What? That is the answer. Why there are no women magicians? Nowhere to hide the tricks." So, you know, I think what I'm doing here is I'm showing you the difference in my work, in that in the one hand, I'm dealing with things that are very light and very fun and very much from the world of entertainment, and on the other hand, I'm dealing with things that are very serious and sometimes quite bizarre. But that is the world I find myself in, and I hope you, if you found this talk interesting, you can come and see our brand new work that we've been working on for 2 years. We're going to open at the Old Vic Tunnels on the 5th of September as part of the London 2012 Festival. And it's called Carnesky's Tarodrome. And we are bringing the major arcana to life. And you will walk through the tunnels and you will meet your own cards, which will be like a live reading. And it's going to be spectacular and fantastic. And it's going to finish with a finale on roller skates. So please do come. I think we've got another film, A Little Bit of the Ghost Train, in Blackpool, because, I don't know if I've run out of time, and I don't know if I've got, there should be another film. Yes, I think there is. So what happened with the Ghost Train, and I might ask you to turn it down a bit, is that we took it to Blackpool. Blackpool Council agreed to rebuild it with me as a permanent attraction. But in the Brick Lane version, it was all very lovely and beautiful and emotive about disappeared women, but that wasn't cutting the mustard in Blackpool. And people wanted to be scared. And I didn't want to lose the themes, but at the same time, people wanted to be scared. So we upped the ante and we made it really scary. And it's still open. It's open all year round. This is the mother character, and she's the mourning mother looking for her disappeared daughters from her derelict, war-torn town. And so what became really odd was that, you know, I tried to make this very serious emotive art project in a fun fair ride, in a ghost train ride. And I mean, it's people go on a roller coaster journey. They're both, it's humorous, but it's also quite sad and quite emotive. And it's an experiment. I don't know if it works. I don't know if you can make a funfair horror house ride about disappeared women. I've done it. Go to Blackpool and tell me if it works. I'd love to know what you think. Thank you very much. Yes, I'm now going to do a magic act to music. Hello.